Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Citus Conference. I'm very thankful that they got the opportunity here to talk to you about Postgres performance. So thank you, everybody, for showing up, and I'm very much looking forward to hopefully presenting some stuff you might be interested in, and hopefully some stuff which you have never seen before. So my name is Hans-Jürgen Schönig. I'm the CEO of CyberTech. We've been in professional Postgres for the better part of 20 years. So I think it's been 23 years now. And we're providing professional Postgres services all around the world, right? So, of course, we've dealt with some interesting customers. You might recognize some of the brand names here. So, as I stated before, we're basically doing a lot of Postgres, Postgres support, Postgres consultancy, high availability, and we're serving people all around the world. So the topic of today is Postgres performance tips you've most likely never seen before, right? So if you are a traveling Postgres consultant like me, and if you're traveling the world for many years, you will see that often a lot of performance can be gained by outsmarting people, right? So the most important thing is that there is performance beyond simply just setting some strange configuration parameters, right? So there is performance beyond PostgreSQL conf. There is performance beyond adding memory. There is performance beyond adding CPUs, right? And the secret part is, if there was a setting that said performance on, guess what the default setting would look like, right? There is no magical variable that says performance on and the default is off, right? That doesn't exist. So obviously there is a bit more, and I'm going to guide you through some of the, I would say, more interesting things you might not have seen before. So let's start with something very simple. Let's have a journey through an application, right? Let's just dream up an application, have a journey. And of course, it starts with creating a connection, actually, okay? So let's take a look at this slide. We have a simple query. It says select one. So the most trivial query you can imagine. And what we do here is we run this query for 20 seconds. We do it with 10 connections to this database, a localhost connection. And what Postgres actually does here on my shiny little Mac Mini is it's going to give us 100,000 transactions per second, right? So that's basically what we can achieve here. We can run 100,000 transactions per second. The question is, how can we improve on that? I mean, we're talking about select one, right? There's surely no configuration parameter that says improve select one, right? So let's see. Let's make a little change here. And all of a sudden, we managed to run 200,000 transactions per second. So what's the difference here, actually? Let me revert one slide. And here we see, on top, when here it says localhost, and if we do this again, the localhost is gone. So obviously, using localhost compared to a local Unix setting, a local Unix socket, is already causing a major difference for this type of query. What it basically means is latency matters. Okay? So sometimes your SQL query is so cheap that sending the request to the database already takes up the majority of time relative to what the query takes. I always keep using this example. If you send a letter to China, it doesn't matter if it's a 5-pager or a 200-pager, right? The problem is your container ship takes a couple of weeks to go there, okay? So it's not that your container ship has infinite bandwidth for as many letters as you want, but the round trip is the problem. And this is especially relevant if you are in a cloud environment, if you are in a Kubernetes environment, or anything that has a long cable or many routing hops in between. So that what we see here is localhost, which is a local machine, compared to a Unix socket, already doubles the speed. Okay? So just imagine what happens if you're going through 500 layers of virtualization and containerization and routing and rerouting and firewalls and cables and whatever. This really matters. So as we see here, 100,000 transactions per second, double the speed to 200,000 transactions per second by just completely eliminating the network, right? So that's the first takeaway. Sometimes your problem is not your query. Sometimes the problem is really just the time we need on the network just to deliver the packet. And you cannot tune that, right? There's no way to tune that. You just have to be aware of it, right? Speed of light is a pretty much of a hard limit, I would say, in many cases. The next thing is when we are storing data, there's also a lot of stuff we can do basically to make this more efficient and faster in general. So let's take a look. I've created a very small table here. And this table contains a varchar variable, an integer variable, a varchar variable, integer, varchar, integer. So obviously what we see here is a mixture of varchar and integer, okay? And then what we do is here, we insert, let me quickly count, 10 million rows into this table, and it's always ABC, 10, ABC, 20, ABC, 30, etc. So we're just filling up this table with some data, and what we got here is a table which has 651 megabytes in size, okay? So the question is, how can we improve on that? So here is how we do it. So we are loading the same data all over again, but this time it's not a mixture of varchar and integer, but we put the integers first and the varchars later. And this ensures that the table is shrinking. If you look at the yellow number at the bottom, we can see that we are moving from 651 megabytes to 574. So obviously our table has become smaller. And the reason is alignment, okay? So the reason here is that Postgres internally is using CPU alignment to ensure that certain data has to start at certain positions in memory and on disk, okay? And by having the fixed size data types first and the variable data types later, we can make the table smaller, okay? Which of course translates to performance and therefore can help us to do efficiency. The problem is in Postgres, the physical representation of data is the same as the logical one if you just do select star, right? And this thing can be used in order to store data more efficiently. Okay, super important. So, but we can do even more. Let's take a look. We create a table. Let's call it T small. Okay. And then we have two random values here. Again, 10 million rows. And then we add default 0, default 0. And we see that the default table is 346 megabytes. If we had created the table directly with four columns and populated the value without a default entry, the table would have been 420 megabytes, okay? So what we're doing here is, in Postgres, alter table, add a constant as a default value, does not eat up space because the value is not coming from the table, it's coming from the system catalog. We know that if there is no value in this row, it's the default value is what's supposed to be there. Okay, so this is going to decrease the size of the table substantially because we're abusing the system catalog in order to provide values. Okay, so we can very nicely abuse that if we have a really large number of constant values. We can add them later and just store the ones that are not default. Okay, so that's one way to shrink a table. Okay, but that's already quite sophisticated, I would say. It's a bit of secret, right? But that's what this talk is about. So once we've connected to the database, once we've created the table, the next thing you might want to do is index a table. And often, indexes need a lot of space, okay? So in average, if you're indexing a typical integer value, a timestamp, or something along those lines, you will need something like 25 bytes per entry just to store the indexes. So in this case, I created a table with some long email address and again, 10 million entries, right? And we index on the email address and let's see what happens. In the first scenario where I just index on the email address, my index is going to be 825 megabytes. The reason is the index has to carry all the values in the table and then refer to the table. So if your index entry is really, really large, this translates to a large index, which might not fit into memory, okay? And often we are on the threshold of fits into memory and does not fit into memory. And this can be a huge difference, right? So what we do here is a little trickery that says hashtags email, and the hashtags function, in this case, it's a functional index on the output of the hashtags function, basically says hashtags of email always returns a number. And a number is a 4-byte integer compared to a very long email address. So what we see here, the index has gone down by 75% almost because we're indexing on a smaller value, okay? And this makes sense. I mean, of course, the problem is this is not fully transparent. It does need a change on the query side because we need the additional where condition in the query, but this is not the proper way to do it either. But sometimes if it's really about squeeze it into memory, because otherwise you have to go to disk, you can't make it because you cannot get enough IO bandwidth because you already have NVMEs and whatever there is, right? So this can sometimes be the only way to handle OLTP workloads on data that is too large to be in memory, okay? So that's a trick. For average email addresses, I mean, not for fake ones like I did, you're saving on something like 40% of index size. And there's a difference if you have a 100 gigabyte index or if you have a 60 gigabyte index, right? So this can make all the difference in the world whether you can do it in one box or if you need 10 boxes, right? So this is a major, major factor, okay? So, but there is more. So once you have connected, once you've loaded your data, once you've indexed, you might want to use a composite data type, something very common in Postgres, a composite data type, which you might see quite often. And the standard example I'm using here is the bgstat-tuple extension. The bgstat-tuple extension is going to inspect your table and it's going to basically check for table bloat. So we want to see, okay, this is a 100 gigabyte table. How much of that is dead and how much is free? So it's basically big, deep table inspection to detect table bloat. And what we often do here is we do select function call dot star. Okay. And what we see here is it takes 3.8 seconds to run. Let me do a small change and see what happens. I can run it in 400 milliseconds. Let's check the difference. So mine, the SQL query. See, here is dot star, and here the star is in the select clause and the function is in the from clause. Here, everything was in the select clause. And the answer is that in the first case, Postgres has to expand the star. So it's going to translate this thing into start double dot table length, start double dot table count, start double dot len, etc. So it has to call the function for every column. If we execute the function only once and expand the column list later, we only have to do one function call. Okay, instead of 8 function calls. It might look more cumbersome to do it the second way, but it's actually 8 times more efficient, assuming that this is 8 columns, 9 columns, sorry. Okay, so this is multiple times more efficient because we're saving on function calls. Okay, so that's you have to be very careful with composite types and query expansion. Because it can really make you suffer quite a lot, I would envision. Okay. So this is basically what happens during expansion, and this is the 3.8 seconds case, right? It just takes a while because it's expanded to multiple function calls, and that's the way Postgres is actually doing that. So let's move on to something else, and hopefully it's something you like. Foreign data wrappers. I mean, foreign data wrappers have been one of the most, let's say, adored features people are using Postgres for. People just love this feature for some reason. They like to have remote data. They like to collect data from different servers. And the way to do that is, of course, a foreign data wrapper. Okay? So what a foreign data wrapper does is it compiles a query, sends it to the other side, fetches the result, and uses it as a local data source, right? So how can we speed it up? Let's wire it up first. So I'm loading it, I'm creating a foreign server, I'm mapping the users, so that's just preparation for a foreign data wrapper, and then we do explain, analyze, select star from email. Right? We're just fetching these emails and see how long it takes. And the answer is 5.2 seconds. But this is only 10 million rows. I mean, 10 million rows, 5 seconds, that's really, really slow. So how can we speed it up? Okay? And the answer is we can use a table option and reduce the time from 5-point-something seconds to 3.6 seconds. Okay, and the way to do that is to use the fetch size option. So what the foreign data wrapper has to do basically is it has to go to the other side, get 50 rows. Go to the other side, get 50 rows. Go to the other side, get 50 rows. So we're using so much network latency all over again. And this is getting worse if by 10x, by 100x, if the remote data size is far away. Okay? So this is already the best case scenario. If we're losing only 50%, this is almost a success story in itself, right? So by just making the buckets we're fetching larger, we can significantly speed it up. Okay? But as I said, 5 seconds compared to 3.6 seconds is that's already golden, okay? It's more like 50 seconds compared to 3 seconds with typical network latency, okay? That's a big thing, okay? So, but sometimes it's also about full text indexes, Okay, so it's not about, foreign data wrappers, it's full text indexes. So let's see what we can do in this area. So let's have an example. I just loaded 2 million dummy entries, right? So if you look at this data, it's just dummy entries, right? So I created the table with full text data type, no vacuum, load 2 million rows, just some checksum, just to make them all different, right? And so what we see here is just some random entries in the table, right? And now we want to search. Okay? So we create an index. What we're doing here is a chin index. It's an inverted index. It's like a search engine index. And we run a vacuum, right? And the way the full text index works is that every word is in the entry list. And the list where this word shows up is in the posting list. So it's like the word tree is on page number 50, on page number 70, on page number 90, and page number 200. The word Australia is on page 64, 95, 380, right? So tree and Australia are in the entry list, in the entry tree, in sorted order. And for every entry, there is a posting tree that contains those things, right? So why do we care? What would be the problem here? So let's imagine we load 3 million more entries. And then we select entries here and we're looking for whatever, and it takes 9 milliseconds. Why does it take 9 milliseconds for just a couple million rows? That's an infinite amount of time, right? So let's check again. The way the chin index is updated is as follows. Imagine you have a phone book. And it says Adam, Bravo, Charlie, Delta, whatever. And you want to squeeze in something here in between. That's a very inefficient operation. So what Postgres does is, okay, it creates the initial index, and it works on the assumption that data is not going to change anyway, because you're indexing law, you're indexing text, you're indexing whatever. It doesn't change usually. So it's putting everything into the fast update list. It just says, okay, use the existing index, but just stuff everything onto this trash can list here, right? So when you do an index scan, you read the entry list, the posting tree, and then you read whatever has not been indexed yet, okay? And this is why it takes 9 milliseconds. If you vacuum, this fast update list is going to be inserted into the real tree in an organized way. It's some sort of bulk index later on. And this is going to speed up our query from 9 milliseconds all the way down to sub-milliseconds. So this is 100 times improvement. So the bottom line is, if you're using full text indexing with chin indexes, it's very advisable that you run vacuum a lot more frequently on this table, because otherwise your indexes are going to be very fast. They degrade as soon as you make a change. And after vacuum, they're randomly back in order. Okay? And this can lead to a bit of unpredictable runtime. Okay? So vacuum often in this case. So that was my best of hidden secrets. How can you make your connections more efficiently by reducing latency? How can you store your data more efficiently? How can you work with composite data types more efficiently? How can you use full text indexing more efficiently? And finally, how you can put it all together to hopefully make your applications better, easier to handle, smaller, more efficient, and in general, just create a better user experience for all your customers. So I hope you enjoyed the presentation. Hope to see you again soon. And of course, we're looking forward to hearing from you. We are hiring, of course. So if you have an interesting CV or just a passion for databases, step forward. And otherwise, let's get in touch. And I wish you a pleasant conference. Thank you for your attention.